come before you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I'd like to begin by acknowledging an act of hate in our own community, not Ascension community, but within our Metroplex, with the standoff that happened yesterday, and offer a moment of prayerful silence. Lord of all faithfulness and all hope, we place our trust in you. Guide us that we may be your disciples, spreading forth your love, your way, and your truth. Amen. Thank you. I'd like to start now by talking a little bit about habits. Now, don't worry, I'm going to focus on the good ones. We'll set aside the bad ones. You can deal with those. Lent is coming. We'll get to those bad habits later. I mean, maybe you need to address some of them on your own. We'll leave that to you. But I want to talk about good habits first. You know, habits are important. They can help. Habits, and I would say sometimes the words, there's a nuanced difference, but habits and ritual, they're important. And whether in particular things would be considered a habit or a ritual may be dependent on the individual. For me, I would say even the way I prepare my coffee in the morning is almost more of a ritual than a habit. And there is something wonderful about that for me. No, that's not true for everybody. Some say yes, down with the coffee, up with the tea. I don't know. But the point is that we, each of us, have habits. Some of them we slip into or fall into. Others we develop or cultivate rather intentionally over time. I think occasionally it's good to spend a little bit of time contemplating them, how they came to be, which ones are good, which ones maybe need a little course correction. And often the new year is a time, so you may be like, yeah, I've already done that, check the box, right? But it's a work in progress, and at least for me, I like that we kind of get to revisit that when we get to Lent and maybe explore both new good habits and doing away with some of the bad habits that have crept into our lives. Now, the reason I raise to you this notion of habits is because I do think it ties very well to this reading we have about spiritual gifts. Because I think it's through the habits that we keep that our spiritual gifts can grow and flourish or be cultivated. And I think that sometimes we do well to explore those two things in tandem. Before I get too much further, I will pause and say I actually would also like to reflect on the notion of spiritual gifts in light of the gospel. We'll get to that in a moment, but the reality is I really like both of these passages and I couldn't decide, but then I saw that they work really well together. I've preached on both, but I don't think I've ever preached on them together, so I was really excited about seeing the connection between the two. Now, some of you have heard entire sermons on spiritual gifts. Some of you may have even taken a spiritual gifts assessment. You can find them online to help identify some of the spiritual gifts that you have. If they are entirely new to you, I would say that even in your living, you might recognize some of the spiritual gifts, some of the gifts that God has placed within you, just in looking around and thinking about things that maybe give you life or make you feel really positive and good, and things that maybe others have noticed that you are particularly good at. I know that at Ascension, we are blessed by the gifts of the many coming together. We hear spiritual gifts in the readings that are offered, in the voices that lead us in song. Other spiritual gifts we might not always recognize or see happening before us, but I'll point out that the altar is always well prepared. We maybe only notice when it's not. This is a spiritual gift, folks. And sometimes there's these divine kind of separations, and I mean this in a positive way, because for me to prepare these altar linens would be an onerous and problematic task. But but for others, it's life-giving and joyful. I was reminded of this over the course of the holidays as well. My family and I got to travel to see my wife's family. Now, we were really excited. We had not had the opportunity to gather for quite a while. And while we were also nervous in this time of pandemic about a gathering of multiple families, because the siblings were all coming with each of their households, it was a magnificent time. And during that time, I was reminded of the spiritual gift that my mother-in-law has for hospitality. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, the thought of cooking for 18 people once, let alone for a week, it was awful for me. Like, if I had to do that, I'd be like, maybe I can escape, or maybe we should cancel the whole thing. Like, as much as I wanted to get together, that would be an awful task. My mother-in-law was in her element. She had been waiting and wanting to do exactly this thing for this group of people for a very long time, and her joy was evident. It probably didn't hurt that we helped do the dishes and things, but she even finds joy in that, which I kind of find remarkable. On more than one occasion, she has offered to iron things, and I look at her like, is this, and she finds joy in these things. And so I just lift that up as an example of the kind of discernment of spiritual gifts. She did not take a spiritual gifts assessment. Well, she may have, but I know that one of her gifts is hospitality because of my observation. She knows it because she's lived it. And I hope that the same is true for you, or that if it's not, that maybe this marks the beginning of an exploration of those spiritual gifts. I think that this gospel lesson from this morning may help illustrate a little bit more about the thing I'm talking about. Now, I would also just pause and say, man, even the difference of the different gospel writers, they each have their gifts that they bring us. John, the Gospel of John, is written and structured differently. And it's one of his gifts because John, or the author of this gospel, is paralleling some of what we read in the Hebrew scriptures from its very beginning into what the gospel looks like, and making sure that we understand why many see Jesus as the fulfillment of the prophecies and the Messiah. And part of that is how and when Jesus steps forward into ministry. And so they talk about a wedding feast, a grand occasion in probably most every culture and each time and place, but maybe particularly so in this time and place. A wedding feast was not an evening of festivities, it was days of festivities. It was an opportunity to gather and reconnect. And more than likely, the gifts of hospitality were present. We don't read about all of those particulars within the gospel this morning, but we can be sure that somebody stepped forward with their gifts to help make manifest all that was during this wedding feast. And it says that at some point, the wine gave out. Now, for some, they'd say, well, that's the indication that the party's over, right? Time to go home, the wine ran out. Or that may be the conclusion of the feast. And Mary calls forward to Jesus, and the words here, this exchange, is a bit odd, almost. It seems out of character from much of what we read in the gospel as Jesus addresses his mother. Woman, what concern is this to you or to me? And I would say to you that Mary has this beautiful gift of calling forward someone into ministry. She happens to be using it in this story and in these verses to call forward Jesus, the Messiah. But like any mother that I have ever witnessed, she knew what Jesus was capable of. And she wanted him to fulfill it in the worst possible way. She was eager to see him live and lean into the gifts that she knew that he possessed. And so when she sees the opportunity at a wedding feast, she says, "Son, look. Look at this opportunity." And even after his initial initial response. How many of us have done this? No, I couldn't possibly do that. That's not my time. I'm not ready. And then with a little bit more provocation, okay, fine. Probably a conversation most of us have had with God at some point. The gifts that Jesus bears are certainly unique. But I hope that if we're thinking about spiritual gifts and we recognize the gifts that Mary has, calling forth someone into ministry, I would hope that we recognize that many in the world around us still bear this same gift. To recognize the gifts in those around them. In fact, we probably each have many of these gifts. Some of us just have them in big ways and others in small ways. So maybe you're the kind of person who sees spiritual gifts in every person you meet, or maybe you're the kind that rarely sees them, but when you do see them, you know for sure that there's a spiritual gift. And in either of those cases, I hope that you will speak up and give voice to what you witness in the other person and call them forward into ministry as Mary does at the wedding feast in Cana. The gifts continue. There are servants there. Their gift may be in part hospitality. They're helping to facilitate things. They take some of the water, now wine, that from these jugs, and they take it to the steward. The steward has a particular gift, a gift that many of us probably wish we had, I don't know, a discerning palate. Although that does sound like maybe it's a challenge too, doesn't it? I mean, if you really have a really discerning palate, then maybe you wouldn't enjoy some of the lesser things that I probably do enjoy. They take this wine to the steward, whose discerning palate is also one that is set to discern whether something was fit to serve the rest of the guests. Spiritual gifts of quality control, if you will. Others have this spiritual gift too. I've witnessed it in my living. Others say, ooh, we need to revise this, or we need to smooth out these wrinkles. Or there are a number of ways that this gift can be made manifest, but the steward in this case has this spiritual gift. That's why they take him the wine, and he recognizes in it something extraordinary, something beyond what he was expecting, and so he names it. And through naming it, through all that is witnessed in this, there are others who come to the spiritual gift of belief, which I think was important for the author of the Gospel of John to acknowledge early in the ministry of Jesus, that these signs, these things that Jesus did while they were moving around the world together, in addition to what they heard him say and teach and preach, the things that they witnessed helped build the belief that sustained them much later as their belief was challenged and living with that belief proved difficult. This place, Ascension, as I look out, I see a room filled with spiritual gifts. Having gotten to know some of you, I know what some of those gifts are. And I've watched as some of them have continued to be developed and cultivated through the habits that we keep. I hope that as we continue our walk together and our contemplation of the gospel and this passage from Corinthians, that we might use the new year as an excuse to evaluate some of our own habits and see where they line up with some of our spiritual gifts. And we might continue to cultivate the gifts that we have been given and let them be developed. Because when one is missing, it is not only the gift bearer who is left short, it is our community. As we seek to recognize and cultivate our own spiritual gifts, it's in our coming together that they are fully realized, honored, and celebrated. So it's my hope that we might use these habits of our daily living to continue to recognize, honor, and cultivate the gifts that we have been given, and then continue to show up to others in this place and in the world around us, allowing God to be manifest through the gifts that we share, because it is in doing that the kingdom of God is created.